Antarctica, the continent lying concentrically about the South Pole. The continent covers an area of about 5.5 million square miles, the landmass being almost totally obscured by a giant ice sheet. It is the coldest and most desolate region on Earth. Antarctic weather is a combination of high winds, extremely dry cold air, and blowing snow. Mid-December, average well below the freezing point over the entire continent. Antarctica has no indigenous human population, but is significant as an area of scientific research. Awesome, fascinating mixture of grandeur, sophisticated science, and the harshest weather on Earth. And yet they come here, hundreds of them, because there's nothing quite like it in the world. They make the trip, endure the hardships, even face danger for one thing, science.
Gentlemen and ladies, you're about to embark on the perhaps the greatest adventure you'll have in your lives. We're going to take you to the most inhospitable place on Earth.
They're getting ready for the season, the austral summer, October to February.
Take your survival manuals with you and study them on the way south. It'll be up to you then to...
Each year, before the season begins, those who go to Antarctica go first to a meeting in the States for last-minute instructions.
Satisfying and rewarding period of work in the Antarctic. We'll try to assist you now in covering the myriad details that are required to make this trip of 9 or 10,000 miles. There are deadlines for shipping and packing that you must meet, and these will be given to you. We'll take you from the States in a military airlift command C-141, which carries about 95 passengers. This is the aircraft that's known as the Starlifter. In a few hours, after leaving the States, you'll be in Hawaii. You have a short refueling stop there, and then perhaps a stop in Pangopango in American Samoa, and then on to Christchurch in New Zealand, which is the traditional jumping-off place for Antarctic exploration and research.
Gentlemen, we welcome you to New Zealand and the city of Christchurch. We trust your brief stay in our city will be a pleasant one. Those 22 persons on the right-hand side of the notice board are scheduled to leave for McMurdo tomorrow morning on a 141 flight departing from the air center at 10 o'clock. For convenience of processing, we've split your flight into three groups, and we have asked all those persons whose names appear under Group 1 to remain at the warehouse immediately after this briefing for a clothing try-on.
Antarctic Personnel Manual, page 15. You will be issued Antarctic clothing as you pass through New Zealand. proper fit is extremely important to achieve maximum protection, and you should be sure each item is the correct size before leaving for Antarctica.
A lunch will be provided on your flight between Christchurch and McMurdo, for which no charge is being made.
For this last long leg of a very long trip, they'll need a lunch. From New Zealand to the ice, it's 2,400 miles, 5 hours in the Starlifter.
First land at Willie Field and step off the plane, you're standing in snow or ice, and you can't quite believe it. You don't quite know where to go. A large number of people are moving about. You must gather your baggage, you must move, but you're not sure where. There are vehicles standing about, a lot of people, none of whom you know. You're directed to some vehicle. You leave there for McMurdo. And you feel like you're in a very strange land. And it takes several days, I think, for one to gain his bearings on just such things as where do you find the linen to make your bed? Where do you find the schedule for meals? Where do you find the building where you go for meals? Everything telescopes. But I think if one is patient enough, it will all sort itself out. And in 2 or 3 days, you do have your bearing. Probably within a week, you feel like an old Antarctic explorer.
Your stay at McMurdo, page one. McMurdo Station is Antarctica's first city. Since 1956, it has grown from an outpost of a few buildings into a complex of more than 100 structures. So this is Antarctica, a village, a frontier town, perched on the edge of a vast frozen continent. Just beyond the village, there's another Antarctica, a land of crystalline beauty, a land of life. Penguins on the edge of the ice, basking in the warm sun of summer, zero or below. They form part of Laboratory Antarctica. Dr. George Lano, Chief Polar Scientist for the National Science Foundation.
The preeminence of Laboratory Antarctica is really in the tremendous abundance of life in the seas around the continent. One might very well ask what biologists find attractive in this part of the world. And one answer lies in the simplicity of the terrestrial and marine biota. And another one lies in the strange and precise adaptations that these organisms have in order to withstand their environmental conditions. And these adaptations emphasize the marginal conditions under which life has evolved and exists, and an understanding of survival under these conditions has important implications.
Survival is important, paramount, and by studying survival here, we may learn much more about it elsewhere. In a laboratory at McMurdo, the emperor penguin is marching for science. A team from Duke University is measuring the cadence, determining the energy budget, finding out how it copes with Antarctic weather. They call it animal engineering, looking into animal design, asking how life functions in this frozen world. Finding out may tell us something about life that's less strange, less precise in its adaptation. Another species of penguin is making a contribution in this field, the adelie. They're yielding up information on brain functions with the help of Dr. Theodore Hamill of Scripps Institution of Oceanography.
This is a film of the bird that we've just finished working with. Now, when water circulates through these four thermodes, that tissue temperature will be determined by the temperature of the water perfusing the thermodes. And that, of course, is the whole purpose of this preparation, to enable us to control the temperature of that tissue. These birds will be tested in the next week to make sure that we have are inducing the physiological effects we expect to see.
We're interested in brain function, obviously.
The thermodes are surgically implanted, and water is circulated through them. Warm water has caused a penguin to eat snow while standing on ice. He thinks he's hot, therefore he is. An important, and for the bird, a painless contribution to understanding.
Then we have contributed to the larger question of how the brain works.
In Antarctica, any activity that's simple elsewhere becomes difficult, time-consuming, even with the help of the Navy, which provides a lot of help in Antarctica. Take fishing, for example. A hole has to be drilled through the 8 feet of ice covering McMurdo Sound. After all that come the fish, and they're worth the effort. It's called the Dasosticus mawsoni, a sort of Antarctic cod, being studied by Dr. Art DeVries and his wife. The fish survives seawater temperatures of nearly -2 degrees centigrade because it has a built-in antifreeze, special compounds that someday may lead to solutions of other freezing problems and perhaps to a better understanding of cancer in living organisms. The key to life in Antarctica is the sea. And these waters may hold the key to life elsewhere in the world. Dr. Mary Alice McWinney, who had trouble finding the laundry at McMurdo, has no trouble finding her samples in the water nearby. She's studying crustaceans, particularly the krill. Mind that word, krill. It's a small shrimp-like organism, a potential source of protein for humans. In the summer in Antarctica, when the annual ice thins out and cracks develop, that's where you'll find the seals. These Weddell seals, mostly mothers and pups, are basking and lolling near Hutton Cliffs near McMurdo. The cracks provide them easy access to the water under the ice. That's where the food is. And this is where a team of scientists are, studying their habits. The team is from the University of Minnesota, and they're looking into population dynamics, finding out where the seals are, in what numbers, where they travel to. The information will help establish guidelines for intelligent management, for quotas, for that inevitable day when the seals are harvested. Sinif relies heavily on electronics to keep tabs on his seals, listening to them underwater as they make strange sounds while diving, and watching them underwater in their graceful dives. These are air-breathing animals, yet they can dive for as long as 45 minutes to depths as much as 600 meters before coming up for air. away from the town, the past of Antarctica reveals itself. Cape Evans is only 12 miles from McMurdo and years back in history. It was the base camp for the British Antarctic Expedition 1910 to 1913, the place where Captain Robert Scott and his men prepared, braced for their historic trip to the South Pole. Their goal was to be the first, the very first, but they also knew that they were not alone. A Norwegian party, headed by Roald Amundsen, had also set its sights on the South Pole. The Cape Evans hut was home for Scott and his men, not luxurious by any means. But Scott in his diary provides the perspective of 1911. The interior space seemed palatial, the light resplendent, the comfort luxurious. Such fleeting hours of comfort are the treasured remembrance of every polar traveler. Comfort and provisions for science. The race for the pole was dominant, but here and along the way, they kept the tradition of inquiry into Laboratory Antarctica. Antarctica, this strange land, there is a place more strange than the others. Across McMurdo Sound, across the ice, there is a region of stark beauty, the dry valleys. Geologists and biologists are here probing for secrets on the early history of Antarctica and of the Earth. History and perhaps the future. Dr. Sam Trebbiz of the University of Nebraska is one of those working here.
The Dry Valley Drilling Project is an international project. It involved Japanese, New Zealand, and American scientists. It was conceived by scientists from all three countries. It was conceived primarily to investigate the geologic history of Antarctica and the Southern Hemisphere, and to do this by drilling critical sequences where the history of Antarctica over the last 20 or 100 million years would be revealed. Okay, the Antarctic is critical to what goes on in the rest of the world. It's a reservoir of fresh water in the form of ice. If this continent melts, melting goes on here, oceans rise. If this continent gets colder and more ice accumulates, oceans fall. So understanding the process that's involved in this kind of thing is what we're trying to do. The product of drilling is core, and we have a saying, a DVDP saying, that our motto is more core. The cores are taken from the hole and boxed and brought to the laboratory, and we do a preliminary evaluation of the cores here to enhance their quality and to signal the importance or unimportance of the core to other investigators who want to look at them. Then as part of our initial monitoring, we cut the rocks into thin slices and use a thin sectioning machine to make thin sections. And we have the best thin section maker in Japan with us here, and his name is Mr. Ono. He's a member of the Japanese scientific team that's come here to support DVDP. And Mr. Ono turns out marvelous thin sections. He's been a great help to us and has provided thin sections such quality and character that we've been able to do a lot better job than we could normally. We look at those thin sections with a polarizing microscope and describe the minerals in the mineralogy of the rocks, and that enables us to identify them more.
Thank you.
This is a very exciting place to work. I think here a man has a chance to work, be at the forefront, at the cutting edge of exploration, and also at the cutting edge of science. He can make a contribution here. He can put his hammer, a geologist can put his hammer to rocks that have never been struck by another geologist. It's like going to the moon, except staying on Earth. This is one of the frontiers. And so, to me, it's a great challenge. And to drill a hole successfully is very, very satisfying. Of course, sometimes Antarctica strikes back and has its own.
This continent holds 90% of the world's ice. And what happens to this ice is important for people in this world. Doctors George Denton and Harold Borns are trying to find out, studying the movement of the ice.
What we have is the fact that the ice sheet in West Antarctica has swept northward, perhaps to the continental shelf, and backward in phase with northern hemisphere glaciations and deglaciations. And probably during the last interglacial, the ice sheet in West Antarctica disappeared. This pattern has repeated itself again and again in the past. And if it continues to repeat itself in the future, what we can expect, perhaps, is the fact that the ice sheet in West Antarctica will continue to collapse backwards, and perhaps it will collapse until it finally disappears, causing sea level during our present interglacial to continue to rise to a value several meters, perhaps as much as five meters above its present level during the present interglacial.
Knowing the behavior of the ice, this 90% is critical, so important that others are studying it too, in a different area and on a different scale, a large scale. So the study demands large-scale support.
There's a tremendous amount that we can learn about our Earth right here in the Antarctic that you can't learn any other place. And if you look at the people that are here now, we get out of it and we all seem to drift back into it because there are as I say, it's a unique place. And so we come back and we put up with the weather and the delays and lost cargo and all of the other problems. And yet, tomorrow morning, if everything is on schedule, we'll have a group in the field and ready to go right on schedule, even though we've had all the problems that we think we've had.
The problems are those of Dr. Robert Rutford, University of Nebraska. He's leading a team of scientists from several disciplines studying the Ross Ice Shelf. It's a mammoth undertaking, for the ice shelf is mammoth, the size of Texas, floating on the ocean. It's fed by the ice sheets being studied by Denton and Borns. Across a vast plain of ice whose movements and future may have implications for the rest of the world. Some of the research is being conducted at the base camp, but much of it is done farther away, out across the shelf, as science teams fan out, supported by a small, commercially operated plane brought in for the project. Away from the sea, the ice shelves, the dry valleys, the continent reaches upward through ice and snow. Different exquisite features, tantalizing repositories of secrets, of answers. There's a paradox to Antarctica. For years, man has come here because it is unique, different. But the real value may be in the fact that it is not separate. It is, with the rest, closely connected scientifically to the rest of our Earth. And that makes it all the more valuable for study, for priority of understanding. Antarctica was once part of a huge supercontinent, Gondwanaland. It broke apart way beyond in the geologic past. Some 40 million years ago, it was joined with Australia, New Zealand, but was pushed apart from that union by seafloor spreading. It drifted southward, began to cool, and the giant ice sheets formed at least 20 million years ago. Fossils of reptiles, ferns, evidence that there were once tropical forests where now there is only ice and snow. This leads to other conjectures. The presence of minerals, of petroleum, coal, the things that keep an industrialized society running, they are here, somewhere, buried under ice and snow. Huge continents drifting apart, cooling off, freezing. It was once just an idea, but the findings in Antarctica have helped turn a vague idea into an accepted theory. Antarctica is unique, it is different, but it is not separate. It's very much with us in ways we only dimly perceive, but are trying to understand. From the Antarctic Personnel Manual, long-range air travel is by ski-equipped LC-130 Hercules, which carries both cargo and people. Flights from McMurdo to South Pole usually take 3 hours. Bring a complete set of survival clothing with you for use in emergency or crash landings. McMurdo to the South Pole, 760 miles. 3 hours. Then it took Scott and his men 2 months. The race for the pole, despite its hardships, was not without its touches of home. Christmas 1911, they sat in the snow and ate Christmas dinner. Pemmican, horse meat with curry, plum pudding, and caramels. Closer, nearer, they approached the pole, expecting a moment of triumph, of being first. Being first to nothingness. Ice and snow stretch out as far as one can see, and farther down than one can dig. South Pole Station sits on ice almost 2 miles thick. And yet we understand, with the early explorers, with Scott, with Amundsen, that there is a certain sense, a certain pride in just being here. In the midst of nothingness, a geodesic dome covering smaller, separate buildings, a hemispheric colony protected against wind and drifting snow. They come here by the score, scientists and engineers, construction workers, and bring with them as much of their world and culture as they can transport. Or recreate. Or improvise. The annual Pole Bowl game doesn't attract many spectators. It may be summer, but the temperature is around 20 below zero. In the long, dark winter, it drops to as low as 110 below. Then there are no takers for football. This place, this outpost in the void, is a triumph of sorts. A triumph of determination and technology. It was denied Captain Scott. He reached the pole on January the 17th, 1912, but he was not first. Amundsen and his party had made it earlier. They were the first, the very first human beings ever to set foot on this place. The Norwegians left behind some food, some clothing, and of course their flag, marking this place, staking their claim to priority. Priority. We may have learned some things over the years.
Mm-hmm.
Antarctic Treaty, 1961. Recognizing that it is in the interest of all mankind that Antarctica, Article 1, Antarctica shall be used for peaceful purposes only.
There shall be
Article 2, freedom of scientific investigations in Antarctica and cooperation. Article 3, information regarding plans for scientific programs. The treaty was signed by 12 nations. They froze all territorial claims in Antarctica and turned this continent into an international laboratory. To call the South Pole unique is barely adequate, because of where it is, at the very bottom of the Earth, it is an important base for scientific research. Not only American research, others are welcome too. The work covers a wide variety of fields and disciplines, the Earth itself, and those brilliant aurora that streak across the southern skies. They're also looking high up into the atmosphere, checking on cosmic rays, those enormous streams of energy coming at us from the sun and from outside the solar system. Knowing more about them can tell us more about the sun and how it affects our Earth. At Pole, they routinely send balloons aloft to gather information on the weather. Charles Jenkins of the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, the resident weatherman and the station's scientific leader.
We have just released a radiosonde transmitter, and this is part of the World Meteorological Organization release times. We are one station amongst the rest of the stations of the world. And these balloons are released two times per day, and essentially all at the same time. What we're attempting to evaluate is the variations in the temperature, humidity, the decrease with temperature and humidity with altitude. And from the South Pole Station, I feel this is one of the most important weather stations in the world.
Once you get caught up in the work and begin to produce some data, it gets very interesting to the investigator. And the reaction to the Antarctic itself, to the South Pole, which is a very bleak and barren landscape or snowscape, is interesting. I have yet to step off the plane at the South Pole and not be reminded of Robert Scott's words when he wrote in his diary when he was there, "My God, this is an awful place."
This is an awful place, and terrible enough for us to have labored to it without the reward of priority. Well, it is something to have got here. Now for the run home and a desperate struggle. I wonder if we can do it. They left the pole, these weary, disappointed men, Scott, Wilson and Bowers, Evans and Oates. They began the long trudge back to Cape Evans. March the 1st. Very cold last night. A minimum of minus 44.5 degrees. Heavy dragging yesterday and very heavy this morning. It became even heavier. Exhausted, sick, out of food and fuel. Scott made his last diary entry on March the 29th, 1912. We shall stick it out to the end, but we are getting weaker, of course, and the end cannot be far. It seems a pity, but I do not think I can write more. R. Scott. Last entry. For God's sake, look after our people.
That these animals are characterized by a high lipid level, by an exceedingly slow growth rate, and by an exceedingly low respiratory quotient. Being a skeptic from way back, I agreed with those who questioned the technological accuracy.
The new Antarctic explorers, they go and return to the States and share their experiences.
And they took 10-meter snow cores and temperatures and established a number of geosiever fixes
Veteran or fledgling, all those who receive grants to work here need close and continuing support, and that spells management of the highest order. And they receive it, not only in Washington, but on the scene, in McMurdo. The frontier town becomes a nerve center for logistics and a rallying point for ideas for people. Only 2 miles away from McMurdo, up over the hill, around the cliffs, Scott Base, New Zealand's outpost on this frozen continent. If McMurdo somehow reflects the American influence, Scott Base mirrors the character and nature of New Zealand. Even the dogs contribute to the flavor of the place. They haven't quite been replaced by the snowmobile. The people at Scott Base have a keen sense of the value of exchange. To their station leader, Harry Jones, international cooperation is not just rhetoric.
Well, here, there tends to be no boundary that you can look over. Our neighbor is just another person who feels cold and has problems when the wind blows very strongly. And he's another person you can get to know very well, even if he's of a different race, a different nation. I think this is why people tend to get along here rather better, and I think it's a very hopeful thing. And if we can meet the challenge which will occur when something economically valuable is found down here, which I'm sure one day it will be, if we can meet the challenge and still get along after that has happened and overcome the human tendency to try and selfishly seize everything for one group instead of sharing it, then I certainly feel that this whole experiment of international cooperation in Antarctica will have been immensely successful.
Я хочу что сказать. Вот здесь мы находимся в Антарктиде. Конечно, очаровательные виды, очень прекрасные виды на горы, на Эребус. Вот много интересного мы здесь видели.
It's a great thing. He has visited the neighbor expedition.
At McMurdo, proof of the success with a visiting team of Russian scientists.
Of the hospitality. And he will tell to all his friends in Russia, when he comes home to Leningrad, he will tell the whole story about the visit in McMurdo, about the hospitality of our Antarctic American friends.
The interchange of ideas and people come easily down here. Ideologies have a way of becoming secondary as people meet and live and work together in a world where cooperation may mean survival. Vostok, the Russian station, is far inland in East Antarctica. The arriving passengers include a returning hero, Dr. Shtanov, a meteorologist who's been working 800 miles away at McMurdo, and Robert Flint, who usually works in Palo Alto, California. He's joining the science team at Vostok. And he soon discovers that California is light years away. Vostok has the somewhat dubious distinction of having recorded the lowest temperature on Earth, 127 degrees below zero. Antarctica provides some surprising lessons in geography. Superimpose a map of the United States over this continent. McMurdo could be New York, South Pole Station, Chicago, and this, it's called Cypress Station, would be Houston. There the resemblance ends. It sits on the West Antarctic ice sheet, miles from nowhere, and listens to the skies. The station is buried in ice and snow, and only the tops of buildings show through. It wasn't built that way. It used to be on the surface, but that's what happens in Antarctica. Seipel is the smallest of the American stations. During the austral summer, there's an influx of people, but in the long, dark winter, when the sun never shines, there are only four. How do people function in such isolation? How do they respond to one another? Do their work, maintain their health? These are, in a way, special people, highly motivated, especially selected. So they function and relate rather well. Loneliness, a sense of being cut off, can be a problem, but not a serious one. And doctors have found out that their health is very good, excellent. But there's a problem. During a long stay, their immunity is reduced, and many are hit with sickness when they come into contact again with the civilized world and its very uncivilized bugs. There are strange sounds at this place, sounds which are recorded and studied for clues to what's happening in our skies. These sounds are called whistlers. Dr. Robert Helliwell from Stanford University explains.
The lightning in the northern hemisphere produces a signal that's heard in the southern hemisphere. And some of that energy may echo back and also be heard in the northern hemisphere. So that if you have stations in both hemispheres, you can hear the signals literally bouncing back and forth with time delays of the order of a couple of seconds. We can draw some diagrams to illustrate what we mean. Let's take this to be the surface of the Earth, and the lightning, let's say, is generated there and radiates signals in all directions, and some of this energy will enter the ionosphere and be guided by the Earth's magnetic field, travels along until it reaches the southern hemisphere and comes out at the receiver sounding like the sound that we listen to on the tape. And that signal, as it travels along the path, exhibits the characteristics of the medium in which it was traveling.
The sister station in this strange relationship, its conjugate point in the north, is Roberval, Quebec, Canada. Together, the two comprise a sophisticated and far-flung network for the study of waves in the magnetosphere. Running in tandem with these studies are others, focusing in on the electron fallout, if you will, of the phenomenon being studied by Helliwell. A group from the University of Maryland studies particles by sending up balloons to very high altitudes, measuring the X-rays produced by those precipitating electrons. Data from both programs will be correlated and studied back in the States.
The reason we're doing this is to find out more about the phenomena of the upper atmosphere. It's a matter of curiosity, primarily, but it's curiosity about a region of our environment that is increasingly interesting to people for other reasons than just getting answers to scientific questions. We have to remember that we're dealing with the fringe of our atmosphere where the solar radiations enter and affect the processes on the Earth. People are interested in the communication applications of what we're doing at very low frequencies, and there are some recent researches that indicate the possibility that some of our weather phenomena are associated with activity in the ionosphere and the magnetosphere.
Thank you. some people bound for Antarctica, New Zealand is not the jumping off place. It's Chile or Argentina, because they're heading for a different part of the continent, the tip that reaches up like a crooked finger towards South America. They follow the route traced out by early explorers who first saw Antarctica and touched it. Palmer, Wilkes, Bellingshausen. They headed south to a strange, uncharted land, and it remained that way for centuries. As late as 1956, the map of Antarctica was almost a blank. Now it's nearly all filled in. Five days out, they know they're heading to someplace different, someplace special. To this place came the early explorers, then the exploiters, whalers, sealers, then nations staking out their claims in a new world. The exploiters are gone. The nations have frozen their claims, but the people still come. Their destination, Palmer Station, the American research base. Actually, it's two stations, one on land, the other afloat. The floating portion is the research vessel Hero, built especially for Antarctic work. Together, Palmer and Hero form a system for research. The peninsula is warmer than the rest of the continent. They call it the Banana Belt. Some places look more like Ireland. Moss coverings, thousands of years old. There is life here in great abundance, in various sizes. The terrestrial mite, the largest indigenous land animal in Antarctica, the size of a pinhead. Life. Consider the Adélie penguin and its intricate and fascinating cycle of life, its patterns of behavior. The mating cycle, for instance, provides a fascinating study. They return to their rookeries in mid-October, late spring for Antarctica. The male begins to collect, or steal if he can, rocks for the nest, running the gamut of others who are intent on the same thing. Then the incubation of the eggs. The male and female take turns at this job, keeping the eggs warm and a sharp eye out for the skua, close by, always watching. The chick is hatched, soon to be abandoned and grow up on its own, to perform its own rituals, to be studied. Life. Elephant seals, appropriately named. They're big enough and they have a distinctive profile which becomes more and more elephant-like with age. These two are studied, counted, like the Weddell seals at McMurdo, planning for the day when the giant ships may come south to begin the harvest. There are legal limits to the harvest, but the men in their ships and their technology will have little trouble reaching the limit. For now, for the scientists, the odds are reversed. Man confronting nature, intelligent man, yes, and prepared and backed up by an organization that reaches out thousands of miles to support him. But still, out there alone in the cold, facing the animals, that's part of the adventure, the mystique of being in this strange place. None of the field work in Antarctica is comfortable, even in the Banana Belt, and diving in the waters of Antarctica may be the worst of it. This team is from the University of California, Davis, and they'll readily concede that this is a far cry from the warm waters of the Pacific. They'll also point out that there's nothing quite like it in the world. Down below in those clear, clean waters is a rich resource of life, flourishing in the most fertile waters in the world. The tanks at Palmer Station's lab hold proof of their telling. Life abundant, varied. Much of the research work is done aboard the other half of the Palmer Station, the Hero. It's used for collection and analysis of specimens. This is no routine fishing expedition. They're hauling aboard samples of the ice fish. Dr. Edvard Hemmingsen of Scripps is leading the study, and Associate Everett Douglas explains.
This group of animals represents a living biological system on the vertebrate level that doesn't have red blood. If you cut your finger, you know, you get red blood coming out of it. If you cut an ice fish, you just get a colorless liquid coming out of it. So we have a very interesting oxygen transport system. And by studying this on the, studying the blood gases, we perhaps can get a better understanding of gas transport in higher vertebrate systems.
They come to these places with profound respect, to the peninsula, to Seipel, South Pole, and to a strange and eerie place in the dry valleys called Don Juan Pond. They respect it because they understand that in Antarctica, they can learn things that cannot be learned anywhere else on Earth. And for that reason, they know it must be protected. At Don Juan Pond, the general concern for environment becomes very specific. They were drilling, seeking new answers, but through their concern and their respect, they stopped.
We have imposed rather severe environmental restraints on the Dry Valley Drilling Project here because Antarctica is, number one, sort of a cold laboratory. There's almost no place like it in the whole world. Don Juan Pond, we're dealing with a unique resource, and we don't want to destroy it. We want to preserve it, and if drilling is going to endanger it, then we're going to stop drilling. And our assurance to all of the environmentalists and to the National Science Foundation, to the rest of the people who are interested in watching us drill this lake, was that we would not drill if we couldn't drill safely. Well, the indication is that we can't drill safely, so we stopped.
The drill rig, the temporary buildings, all were taken down, lifted out, to make their contributions to science some other place, but not here. Don Juan Pond was abandoned, left to its own, unspoiled, left to make a later contribution to science. The cycle of work of discovery continues through the years. Scientists, technicians, old, young, all excited, gather to trade stories. Stories of blizzards, of the food down there and how it was, good and bad. Stories of how life is, how the little things count. Mail from home, news from the outside. They trade their stories and prepare their expectations for the coming season. And the seasons themselves cycle from winter to spring, then to summer, when the ice becomes soft and yields to the push of the icebreaker churning its way across McMurdo Sound, passing over the spots where they collected fish and counted seals and ran their dog teams, even where the planes once landed. After the icebreakers come the ships, bringing in their cargo. Soon they'll all leave, the ships, the planes, the people. Left behind will be a small band of people waiting for the sun to set, waiting for the long winter. And even then, in the dark, in the quiet, the search, the inquiry will go on. Thank you. Antarctica, the continent lying concentrically about the South Pole. The continent covers an area of about 5.5 million square miles, the landmass being almost totally obscured by a giant ice sheet. Antarctica has no indigenous human population, but is significant as an area for scientific research. Antarctica.